Yeah, we were already talking a little bit before, and I think we might revisit some of the things that we were discussing. We ended with the question of life, and we will eventually get there.
We won't stop there, though.
No, but as a way of moving from questions related to the material to quite existential questions, I was first very curious to ask simply how you make the decision to pick particular materials. How do you meet these the materials? How do they come to you? What is that first moment like when you get in touch with something that will later become part of a work? What's happening in this moment? How
No.
does it all start?
No, I mean, that's one of the difficult questions, but I can say, I mean, I'm not searching all the time, but when I'm searching for something, I consider everything that passed my eyes, my information, any kind of source, sort of test it against a desire or need in one way to see if it ca somehow connects, if there is an affinity to my wish.
But
So for that reason, it's very hard to say how it happens because I can't recall it myself easily. But I mean, I can talk about this state of searching.
which you described before as okay, there's everything, there's the flow of everything around you, and then suddenly something pops out that intuitively you grasp and then start working on to see whether it actually can do something.
No, I usually have a rather specific aim for what I'm searching. So it's not that I take something and say, what can this do for me? So I have a kind of searchlight, which is not formulated well in words, but still it's rather a specific beam I'm sort of out with. But of course, every impulse is not good, for certain.
So there is a series of things that eventually got back into the cupboard.
Definitely. I mean, the world is not constructed that way, that everything that pops up in your head is a perfectly bright idea. You might have noticed in some of your cases.
There's always the morning after. But when some of these elements suddenly seem to be doing something, you will then also spend quite some time continuing to look for more of it. You were saying that these are, we said we wouldn't be pointing at things, but since we're sitting in front of you.
This one is extremely present. But this is also a very special case that was presented to me. I mean, most other decisions are a little bit more of a search, and these beaver cuts were just presented to me as so amazing that I had to collect them.
You were saying before, because I was absolutely totally ignorant of what it was, that at some point Stockholm was had a
It was beaver infested. They were even everywhere, also in the rather central parts of Stockholm, and it was a problem because there are canals and there are a lot of shores in Stockholm where there are trees, and if beavers cut the trees there, it's devastating to the seashore.
So at some point, Stockholm, you would find these chips everywhere around town, or
Maybe not everywhere, but but from being an animal that was almost extinct, they were planting back, and suddenly they had reproduced in such a way that they were everywhere. And very common.
You also, at one point, I read a statement where you said, well, the meaning of the work is everything that's around it. So they you're kind of in constant contact with your environment through certain forms. No? There's an object that is what it is in itself, but it speaks a lot about what surrounds it in ways that one can probably not easily turn into words. No,
no, but I mean, from not easily turn into to words, I think I said that what bounces off from the object, you have your attention towards the object, and let's see what comes off, like a physical or chemical reaction. But earlier I also did what I called models, and then more like when a mathematician makes a model which they think is just fine. They know that there is something in this structure that's good, and at some point they are certain that it could be applied to something.
Mm-hmm. Like a model for something, but you were also speaking about that moment of, I guess in dance you call it momentum, no? When something just sets off a motion and then it bounces off the object in a particular way.
Yeah, but there are slightly different dynamics to these two things. I mean, in one way you could say what sort of bounces off, and within these more model-like things you see a structure that somehow could be applied to something, but you don't know yet. But that was why I mentioned mathematics, because they're always so certain that when I have this structure, sooner or later it will fit something.
Yeah. There's a lot of scientific experiments where they find something that they can prove by the experiment, but they do not yet know what they have actually proven.
No, that's from the other side also, that...
Yeah.
Something happens and I need to explain it.
Yeah. It's a beautiful example, like where every work could be an experiment that definitely proves something. We're not quite yet sure what it will be.
No.
Yeah. And you were also saying, like, I was thinking, like, being raised on German romantic theory, obviously I associate that dynamic of pushing towards something which itself is not fully given with the logic of the fragment. If the whole is too big, we just have a little piece, and that little piece out of its negative fragmentation speaks about the whole. But you were immediately saying, yeah, you know, stay away with that.
No, to me fragment seemed a bit too romantic, and in a way my aims are enormous.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not in a megalomaniac way, but sort of wide.
Yeah.
So, no.
But to relate to these enormous aims, we don't need to talk about a piece that relates to the whole.
Mm-hmm.
But you were talking about an experiment, a structure,
mm-hmm.
an object that allows for things to bounce off into that enormous space.
Mm-hmm.
I remember terms that you were using in one of your texts was that you were talking about the enormous, like about expansion as something that starts from the work, no?
Mm-hmm.
A way of thinking expansion. Could you say a few things about that? Like when you say my ideas, these ideas are enormous, I'm thinking about a full expanse. What do you connect with that moment of expansion? Or an expanded idea, and constantly expanding idea of art?
Yeah, I think I would rather relate to it in the way that if sort of meanings or contexts bounce off, they could be rather different,
mm-hmm.
and that field of two or three directions together makes a rather complex or so it's not evenly spread. I mean, not like an expanding universe or anything like that, but sort of particular threads of meaning that could go off in different directions.
Yeah.
I feel more at home with that than a sort of general expansion.
Mm. And before you were talking also about the model of curling as a form of thinking about the process of making art, or a friend of yours was speaking about curling as the answer. Could you say a few things about that, like how you related to that sort of?
I don't know exactly what you mean, because I made one little drawing that was thing in New Zealand. I believe that you should make the work for the next millennium, and then I put curly on the top, and what was in the bottom. I don't exactly remember that anymore. But when you're talking about it here and now, of course it relates in a way to the paperworks in here, because speed and curliness are closely together. The faster anything goes, it's more energy and more curly.
What I was thinking of, like, as we were talking before, you mentioned a friend was talking about the sport of, what is it called, the sport where you throw that disc and you have to rub the floor so that it keeps...
Curling.
That's the one.
Yeah.
And you were saying that is a good way of thinking about what happens in art, that there is a possibility to create these kind of strange things that may or may not start gliding and go a long way, or sit there suddenly, which is another way of thinking how a piece might open up a certain kind of future unknown territory. It either glides or it doesn't.
Yeah, sure, for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, it's always hard to calculate how a thing takes off, but also, I mean, since not being a young artist anymore, of course I could see how different works sort of glides on and takes on new meanings.
And it takes a fair lot of amount of scrubbing in front of it.
Maybe that's done by context, the world or things happening.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not me scrubbing, that's for certain.
The world makes it glide or doesn't.
No, but I mean, what happens after the work is done, of course, influences the meaning.
Yeah. So we've been thinking very much out into this expanse, but for me it was also interesting to realize that you have come out of a generation of people that were heavily, to some extent, that witnessed or were influenced by punk. No, I met your colleague when I was starting to teach in Umeå, Stig Sjölund, who was part of a group that you did together in the 80s, and you were saying that you studied in London and were surrounded by the whole punk thing, and that it left some kind of impression on how you go about making work. Could we briefly talk about that?
No, I think what came out that was very healthy was that you could start doing something. You could just start with whatever means you have, rather than to wait and apply for money or be recognized by somebody else, and so on. I think it was a good start for me, and I, in that way, which I didn't realize then, but I also avoided some of the hazards of being a young artist, like a groupie hanging around power structures or whatever, which could be difficult.
But it's the energy of taking something, making it work, putting it out in projects, exhibitions. But you were said before, like when we were talking about how the art work, how making art today has changed.
Oh yes.
Yeah. That today in a society where I guess also in Scandinavia a lot of it depends on public funding.
Yeah,
it's difficult to maintain that kind of punk spirit, or how do you look at what's happening
of
today?
Of course, that was a specific moment in time, and I think I was lucky in that way to be there. And it was also a little bit of gap from a generation before me that wasn't present in the art world so much.
Mm-hmm.
The 68 generation, that didn't go into art very much, so that they went into theater, journalism, and other things. And suddenly, I mean, if you look at artist records, my age straight, there you have a peak like this.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not only me.
So 68 generation goes into theater, suddenly the art becomes a free field where you can make films.
I wouldn't want to romanticize this punk thing too much, because it was actually a free space to fill when I started, and that space closed a couple of years after that. So.
Yeah, I see. But later, just before, you were joking that today, also through art education, I know it too, a lot of people are immediately forced to conceptualize their work as projects, which you find problematic.
I mean, for some people, I'm sure it works, but for me, it's devastating to have to put things into words in a very early stage, and apply and then wait, and at the time you might get money, you're bored with the idea. I mean, you don't have this momentum where things come together. So I think it's problematic to conceptualize some things too early in your thinking.
And this other horizon that is not, let's say, the time pocket of a project with an aim and a deadline, I guess when I look at your work, when I experience it, like you have it's a wide horizon of time, of traveling, of making experiences, going back to certain themes, or finding new experiences, and going out into the world and making experience is quite crucial for you.
Yeah, absolutely. But as a resource, because I wouldn't deny that making something concrete, having a deadline, is the only thing that makes things happen. Otherwise, I could just move around a little this and that.
Mm-hmm.
So that creates a lot of energy too, to have a definite deadline.
Now
I have to do it. Now it's time to start searching immediately.
But if we speak about the other side of the practice, where you have been traveling, and it feels like I know a lot of people who go on research trips and of course usually come back home panicking with too many photos, too much material. Oh my God, how am I going to turn that into a work? And there's something about your work that on the one hand is fast and punkish, but also laid back, in the sense that I don't need to just give you everything that's in my suitcase.
No.
There is something about, like, okay, let experience be experience, and if it finds its way into the work, it's cool, but I don't need to force it. At the same time, you are, or have been, are still a traveler, and have made very important experiences, I guess, going to the Arctic, or going to the desert, and all of these things. How do you, what is, for you, the thrill of traveling or making such experiences, how can one talk about it without wrapping it up too quickly? Mm.
I think I start out as thinking of it as something else, as leisure.
Yeah.
I mean, for quite many years as an artist, art practice was the whole thing, and every trip has to be tax deductible or anything connected to the work.
Yeah.
So you travel to European cities and so on. And then came a point that I must do something else.
Yeah.
So it started out like that, to have some leisure, to have some other world that was not connected with the art world.
Yeah, which I think for me is always so important to. I have so many conversations where I'm trying to point to that, because I feel like today we all live in the shadow of this pressure to professionalize,
mm.
that everything somehow needs to be channeled and funneled back into some form of production, and to think about the need and necessity to open up a world of experience of which one doesn't immediately know whether it leads back to the work or not. I think it's it sounds so simple, but I think it's fundamental, no? To keep insisting that world of experience is vital for life and art, and then now we're back to life.
I agree with you that at some point you don't know what will become of it.
But for a lot of people, like, work might be organized in the framework of projects, but I have a feeling with your work it's really existential on the level that there is always that sense of there is a life that's going on. You are somewhere, we have a piece of you, but the life of the artist is continuing somewhere. I sometimes have similar feelings with Lawrence Wiener, where I always feel like there is a post-it note on the wall saying Lawrence is out somewhere.
Yeah.
This is the piece, but he will be having fun somewhere.
Mm.
And the work stands in relationship to a life which it will never fully encapsulate, but somehow still stands in a relationship to it, no?
Mm.
Like, Eva will be out somewhere in the desert near you. Or
closer than that. But,
but like, it's such a big word and such a big topic, but speaking about, let's say, an existential horizon of making art or being an artist as something continuous, would you have any thoughts on that?
No. Sometime you start to think about how, I mean, you must survive as a person to do different things.
Am I allowed to ask a
question? Yeah, you're on the sofa. Yeah.
If somebody would ask you, what is your profession? What would you say?
The first time I wrote artist, some kind of form, it was an important moment. It could be hotel or whatever, fill in your profession. And socially, of course, I was...
But you will answer that you are an artist.
Yeah, I mean, in any social context, I would answer that, yes.
So who eventually you think is an artist? Somebody who has a diploma? Or how you say who is an artist and who is not an artist?
It's not up to me to judge who is an artist and who is not an artist. I'm not judging that. And
because an artist is not a profession, I think. Because there could be a cook who is an artist, so his profession is cooking.
No, but I mean, the word artist, of course, could be used in different areas.
Yeah.
and now we are in an art context. And
but I think Marcelo.
But since we've already opened up the conversations, if you want to join in, does anybody have a I think we touched on many of the things that were of interest to me, and obviously there's big concepts in the air where it's not so easy to get a grip on them, but I always have a sense of, like, it's good if there's a certain perfume in the air where these words contribute to the smell that's surrounding the work. Questions from you in the room?
Are these all finished projects, or is it continuous threads of your artist practice, or is this umbrella thing, is it now one body of work, the drawings with the thread, wire, or is it?
I can answer it two ways. I mean, sometimes I feel that I waste a lot of ideas or strategies because I sort of do something once and I'm not able to continue, because it, somehow it has sort of, I have done what I wanted, it has lost its tension, I can't do it anymore. And many times I had wished that I was an artist that could sort of continue more smoothly from one thing and develop it, as is called, into the next. I very rarely succeeded in doing that. But that doesn't mean, of course, that becomes, if you see works over a long period, of course you could see that there are certain threads that are done and appearing again and so on. So even though the size, material or whatever is changed, I think it's quite easy to see that some things are also coming again.
To me it also looks like you, like the installation in the big room, you do it and to find out something. It's a bit like, oh, I'm using this, I want to gain some knowledge while doing it. Is that so? Beyond language, I put things together and then let's see.
Yes, of course, that's so. Always an aspect that I put things together and see what it that's very close to a practice, of course, that one does that.
Do you comment the titles of the works or of the show, or how you title works?
We talked a little bit about that because, I mean, the titles are also aspects of the works are very based in the present moment, and this present moment has kind of a mood to it, and of course it has to do with myself, but it's also sort of widespread sense of the world and the surrounding. And what I could see now with this show and also a former show I did in Florence, that it's kind of sort of heavy or a little sadness or a little fatefulness tinge to the mood in it. And I mean, obviously that's something I have absorbed from the situation. And at that level, if you're talking about, apparition or aura or mood or what comes through, I mean, beyond all the particular things that might be that and that and mean that and that and are connected like this and that, of course, there is a total mood to the show of a certain moment, and that could vary, and that's not until I see the finished work I really could see that this became so
and one of the titles that you previously used also in Italy was, what was it, Earth?
The Earth as we know it, but that was the work of that installation.
Yeah. When we were briefly talking about that before, like the whole notion of like, yeah, you speak about the mood and atmosphere, but also like environmental concerns.
Yeah.
They are somehow present or echoing in the room as one of the many contexts.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. If we were to speak a little bit more about that and speculate on that, you speak about a strange. How would you describe the mood that you are tapping into that when it comes to Earth as we know it?
Of course, I mean, I got the idea, I decided to use it, and then I realized it was a very detached, in a way, thing. Maybe feeling that things were distant or that I was not part of it, but also part of it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
A feeling of detachment that I couldn't control, maybe. And also, of course, in this title, the Ukrainia's seeds, it's very, I mean, Ukrainia seen as a hypothetical time period. Past, future, don't know exactly what, and then to have the seeds, that is the sort of potential, I mean the fruits and the potential offspring of this period makes it also kind of both distant and also a little bit creeping, like germ or whatever, creeping. So in a way it's detached, that it's a logic you don't entirely understand or can examine, analyze, but it's sort of coming.
Mm-hmm. Someone else?
Let me point out the sculpture that you have in front of you, which for me seems the epitome of totally disparate material, which eventually creates some kind of phallic, Brancusi-esque, but still keeps it on the ground, like the material has something to do with beaver, leftovers by beavers, and the plastic spoons seem to leave their function as plastic spoons and become something else. And it's all held together with, I insist, with a material called Fuji rock. When I first knew Eva's work, she was working with an incredible plaster-like material which was used in the dental industry, called, it was Japanese, so Fujiyama, and rock, so it was called Fuji rock. Now, today she told me that this is not Fuji rock, but it's something similar.
Yes.
But this is for me the most, really the sculpture as I know Eva's work. Totally bizarre, and yet absolutely perfect in shape and color.
Isn't that a great ending, Klaus?